Because to get to be a part of these kids and these coaches and the support staff's lives for even that small window and make that connection and give them a sense of hope back is, it's the greatest job there is.
Welcome to another episode of Beyond Coaching, where we explore coaching the 21st century and leading the 21st century athlete. Got with me today, Coach Kaz. Kaz, who has an incredibly interesting story, but a coach, a licensed counselor, does a lot of mental health, mental wellness work with student athletes now. And I heard her speak this summer at a convention. I thought I got to talk to her more. So Kaz, thanks for joining us today.
You bet. Yeah, you bet.
Well, let's jump into it. You have a, as far as I know, a unique journey. I don't know anybody else like you. So give everybody kind of the background of what you've done professionally, how you ended up where you are today.
Sure. You know, I always say life gave me almost every experience an athlete slash coach can have. And I'm grateful because it prepared me for the million conversations I have with student athletes and coaches now. So there's very little that they can say to me that I'm like, oh yeah, I haven't like seen that or been through it. So I'm really grateful for my diverse background. So I actually grew up in a small town in Southern Oregon, even though we were a huge high school and athletics was definitely the big focus. And I actually graduated in my class. There were 6 Division I athletes, which is a lot. One wanted to be an All-American. Three of us went to Pac-12 schools and one became an Olympic medalist. So sports was really like an intense thing where I grew up. Then my goal was I really wanted to play for the Ducks and I wanted to be an architect. And to be honest, that did not work out because they had a coaching change and I followed the assistant coach out to Utah. And I'm also very grateful that that's how things played out. Even though I wanted to be an architect, I really wanted to coach. Like I always wanted to be a D1 coach. That was really the dream. And it was a great fit for me at Utah. And my head coach there, pretty much was mentoring me from the time I got there. She pulled me in early and goes, "Hey, we want you to stick around and coach when you graduate." I'm like, "Dude, I'm like 18 years old, you know?" But I was blessed that she like just poured into me and taught me how to coach all the way along the way. And then I actually got injured, in my sophomore year that it ended up turning into, I ended up having 2 spinal fusions in like a 9-month span. So I went from starting every day, to not being able to play very much to, my career ending. And that was really difficult for me, because softball is like, I mean, it was the thing that mattered to me in my life. And, I went through a period of depression after that and nobody talked about mental health, 20 years ago. I went to our sports psychologist and we had one of the top in the nation. And I went to him and I said, "Yeah, you know, I think I'm depressed." And he looked at me and he's like, "Well, I don't do depression." I was like, "Then what do you do?" And he's like, "Well, I do performance." And I was like, "Okay." And so I went to my team doc and told her, I said, "Hey, I think I'm dealing with depression." And she actually started laughing. And I was like, "Okay, I don't need you to laugh at me, you know?" And she goes, and I go, "Why are you laughing at me?" And she goes, "It's been 2 years." She goes, "I can't believe you haven't been here earlier." And, so I ended up seeing a counselor and I actually went to a campus counselor and I was like, "This is horrible. This is not this is not going to work." Cause I had explained sports to her. And then I was really fortunate and moved to another counselor and he had been a former injured athlete at the University of Utah. He'd been a baseball player. And that was such a saving grace for me. And I think that kind of opened the door to what I do now. And all along the way, I think there were kind of signs leading to it. My head softball coach on my club team, he's a psychologist. And then I found this guy in Utah. And I coached at Utah for 2 years. And I really thought that was the dream. But honestly, the chronic pain I was suffering from my back, it just wouldn't allow me to do a D1 schedule. And I learned that D1, I love playing it, but it was not a fit for who I was as a coach. And so I came home to the Pacific Northwest and I started coaching at Concordia Portland. And the team was like 6-27. They were horrible. And I was making like $10,000 a year. And I'm like, "I'm going to make them care about softball here." And I was the only female coach. The next coach close in my age was 12 years older than me. I was 24 and I did not, I to be honest, I think I was too dumb to be afraid of being a head coach at 24. And we were able to turn that team around. And by the third year we were at the regional tournament. And as I coached, like our teams continue to grow, but the big changing point is when I became the assistant AD over student welfare there. And I had That happened right between my two ADs. I had two great ADs that I worked for, Joel Schulheist, who hired me. And then I worked for Matt English. And Matt actually came from the Ducks, ironically, and he was a fundraiser. And we were two young kids running a department. Neither of us was even 30, but he really believed in student welfare. And I told him, I said, I need to go back to school because the kids are now coming to me with things that are kind of above my pay grade. And so I went back to school. I went to Western Seminary, which is actually one of the top counseling schools on the West Coast. And it was close to school, close to work. So I went there while I was coaching and having kids. And it was, I would say, it's probably the best thing I ever did for myself. And I knew that I needed to go into counseling because kids were struggling with their stuff. It wasn't as much performance. It was their stuff was impacting their performance. And so once I left coaching, I tried to be a normal counselor. I really, really tried, but I epically failed at it. I don't have office all day. I don't handle being in regular clothes. I switched to being like not a school counselor, but I was seeing clients on their campuses. And so I love being with teenagers and I was still working with athletes, but not just the degree I do now. And through COVID, I was actually on my kiddos' campus. They were at a private school. And to be honest, we were just kind of trying to keep people alive and keep people functioning. And so I really did focus on that. But on the side, I got really engaged with College of Idaho. And it's funny because they were like one of my biggest rivals. And now they're like some of my dearest friends. And their head softball coach, Al Mandiola, we were sitting there and he goes, hey, Kaz, like, I don't even know what you're doing for a living. And I was explaining to him and kind of some of my philosophies about things. And he said, Kaz, I need to change who I am as a coach. He goes, what? My style is no longer working. And he's like, can you come help me? And I go, yeah. And so next thing I know, I'm with the whole athletic department, standing in front of 400 athletes and talking about mental health and stuff. And we saw the change in success in softball. It was so dramatic. They went from not making the playoffs to being one game out of the World Series. And then the next year they finished third in the country. And I would say, it's not because I'm a genius. That's not what I'm saying. But I watched Al change as a coach and how he started building relationships with his athletes, communicating differently, just things changed. And their performance improved dramatically, right? And I saw Al as such a happier guy. You know, when I first started coaching against Al, to be honest, I always joke, I go, I hated you. Like, you're grumpy and all this stuff. And now he's like my brother. Like, I love that man. But I've seen him grow as a person, but also to match how he could support his athletes. Right. And so now he's the first person in small college I send kids to, him. And then my buddy that's down at Concordia Irvine, cause she's the same. Like, she is an amazing woman, amazing coach, really builds great people and they win. And so I always want to send people that I care about to those programs, right? You want them to have that. So College of Idaho is super supportive. Regan Rossi has been like, you know, my sidekick in this of like, how do we help programs develop this and how do we offer resources? So I started building my company, Train the Complete Athlete. And we actually have an online platform so kids can access support, whether it be like masterclasses or it kind of runs like a Facebook streaming thing. We have live stuff every week. They can reach me because the kids, they don't, you know, they're not struggling at 10 o'clock when they can walk into a counselor's office. They're struggling when they're in their dorms or in the hotel or, you know, when they can't get to people. And sometimes it's not that kids need, that they need somebody to talk to all the time, or they need a counselor. They just need some information, right? And so we really wanted to make sure that these kids had access to it whenever they need it. And as we grow and we're adding counselors, we're actually adding counselors that all have college backgrounds. Because one of the differences between me and the, you know, a traditional counselor is I understand the grind of being an athlete and a coach and a recruiter and an injured kid and all these things that go along with it. So when I sit across from a kid, they're like, okay, you get it. You understand my language. You understand my lifestyle. And lots of times athletes do not want to talk to somebody that doesn't get their lifestyle. Plus I'm definitely more direct than the average counselor. I probably am much more coachy and I definitely am probably more humorous and sarcastic, but honestly, most coaches are humorous and sarcastic. So
absolutely.
And I always watch athletes and I'm like, oh my gosh, I can tell that you're drowning in feelings. Let's talk about something ridiculous. And I'm never shy to be able to say, let's talk about stupid things or, you know, whatever. And so it's been a huge blessing to be able to be on campuses. You know, this is, I don't even know, fourth campus, fifth campus, like in the last, I don't know, month. Cause I, you know, I'm currently at an NAI campus talking to you at another NAI campus. And every school I am at, I'm always like, no, this is my favorite school. Oh no, this is my favorite school. Because to get to be a part of these kids and these coaches and the support staff's lives for even that small window and make that connection and give them a sense of hope back is, it's the greatest job there is, right? Because kids are so eager for guidance. They know that there's struggles, right? And this is what I learned so much at NACTA is from assistant or from ADs is they're putting resources in front of these kids, but they're not grabbing them. And my challenge to the kids now is why, right? Why are you not grabbing them? And my professor, who is a really brilliant man, he goes, well, it's called emotional entitlement. And I was like, no, I'm not. Everything's about entitlement. Seriously. And he goes, no. He goes, so many people want others to work around their feelings and their mental health. I go, you're 100% right. And I communicate with athletes. I go, guys, this is kind of like how speed and agility was when I was in college. It was like the new craze. I go, well, guess what? It's still here. I said, this is not a craze. This is going to be a new form of your training. I said, and you need to embrace it and take responsibility for it, right? And not be afraid of it. I think that's the other thing is kids are just afraid of really facing, as one of my clients says, that ugly mirror, Miss Carrie, that you would put in front of my face, you know? And so we talk about even that, like what makes this a hard thing to work through, right? And so we answer a lot of those questions. And when I'm on campus, I get to train coaches how to connect and how to deal with the things that are more than they're trained to do. Because we ask coaches of small colleges to do an insane amount of things, yeah. Right? And I always say, I'm like, that's why I could do any job because I've been a small college coach. I've had every job description there is, right? Even down to driving vans and throwing parties and, you know, it's everything. And now we're asking these coaches to play mental health counselor because most of our campuses only have one or two counselors. Most of them don't have a sport background. And the way we built our company is we were trying to meet as many kids' needs for the lowest price as we could, because there's a major budget crisis in schools right now. And so we never wanted money to get in the way of how can we support a student athlete, right? And I think that's become one of the hard things. Lack of counselors in the world and lack of financing.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I got a page of questions in front of me now that I didn't have before we started. So
yeah. We
may go some different directions than what I told you initially.
Go for it.
All right. I want to go back to, I thought it was fascinating how you talked about Al from College of Idaho.
Yeah.
Talk about how you worked with him and how he changed. You said that several times about him.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I'm like, I love Al and I'm going to talk about him, but can I talk about a different coach at College of Idaho?
Sure.
Okay. This is like, I think this is the biggest transformation, right? Cause I knew Al as a dad and a husband and his interactions, right? So I knew that was a part of who he was. But then I started working with College of Idaho basketball. And when I first worked with them, I remember walking in with the boys and the boys were tight. Like those guys, like they would do anything for each other. And I walked in and I go, guys, like, so, you know, how can I help you? And they just literally almost crossed their arms like, coach, we got this. And I go, okay. And I just kind of stood there for a minute. I go,
let me interrupt for a second. For those listening, College of Idaho men's basketball is incredible. They've been really, really good.
And so when I met them, they were like top 20 in the nation. Right. And so I said to them, I go, guys, how many of you been past the first round? And you know, these kids kind of arrogantly throw their hands up and I go, how about the second and only one hand's in the air? And I go, okay, yeah, we should maybe talk about that. Right. And so, you know, they think I'm going to come in and make them lay on the floor and talk about their mom. And I'm like, no, dude, we're talking about winning. We're still going to talk about winning. Right. So we spent an hour and kind of talked about how we can get to the next step. And it's funny because Colby at the time, like he wouldn't come to the coaches meeting. He and I didn't barely interact. And I was like, okay, well, it will be interesting to see how the season goes. So the next season went and they finished, I think it was one game out of the final four. And so I was really excited to get back to them and see kind of what happened, right? Or didn't talk to them. So I go, guys, what happened? And they're like, cause we choked. And I go, no, what happened, right? And so we literally, they're like, cause, you know, we were up at this point. So we broke down the last 5 minutes of the game that they gave up the lead and lost. And that knocked them out of the tournament. And I said to them, and I go, so guys, like, you know, what are you thinking needs to happen? And one of the kids just kind of looks at me, what he was describing to me, I go, well, it sounds like you think you need to be a D1 team. And they're like, yeah. I go, well, guys, do you know how many D1 kids go down to the NAI? I said, the teams you're going to have to beat are going to have D1 kids. So how are we going to do that? I said, how do you become a D1 team? And to be honest, they had no idea. So I was like, well, guys, these are the things that separate small college from D1. And we started breaking down the things that needed to happen. And I said, can you commit to that? Because that's a big commitment, a lot of discipline. They're like, no, Koss, we're in. And sometimes you believe it, that team, when teams say that, and sometimes you don't. But I know when College of Idaho men's basketball, when the boys say something, they do it. There's no questions. I never doubt. And then it was funny because Colby comes into the office I was using later. He goes, hey, are you coming back? I'm like, when? He goes, in the spring. And I go, I think. And then he goes, they talk about you. And I go, oh, crap. I don't know if that's good, Colby, or not. And he goes, no, they're referring to the things you talk about. I go, okay, well, good. I'm glad. That's awesome. And then he goes, Koss, I know you can't tell me what the kids said, but can you? And I go, I just look at him, I go, Colby, I said, they're ready to be pushed to the next level. So you can go ahead. And he goes, are you serious? I go, let's go. And he goes, okay. So I showed up at their game at Warner Pack, and you know, the coach that didn't interact with me, like, comes and sits with me. He tells me all about this amazing nonprofit that's called, actually called Jace Foundation, that the boys went to. And it's a suicide awareness that actually gives cowboy boots out. And he showed me the picture of the boys in the boots. I've actually been to the Jace Foundation to get my own boots. And we just sat there for the whole first half. And I'm just like, wow, I see a totally different guy. He's so much more of a big picture guy. And he goes, okay, I got to go to work. And he, you know, left with his team. And then he, like, I mean, they totally destroyed that group. The funny thing is that season they lost the very first game. And I was like, oh gosh, this is all not really going to work out. And then they never lost again. And they won the championship. I mean, it was like 15 points, right? And it was so amazing, not just for them to win a championship, but to see these boys and this coach totally transform. As I say, they were always good, but they did those little detail things that got them to the end, right? And now when things happen, in Colby just calls. He's like, hey, Koss, what's going on? And I would be like, you're in the off season, Colby. You shouldn't have to be calling me at 10. He's like, I'm on my couch. It's fine. And you know what? If something happens, we work it out. We get things back on track. And Colby just jumps to it and does an amazing job. And, you know, so I see these transformations in kids and our coaches. And I had a group that asked me, well, how long is the transition? I go, and I started thinking, I go, 2 years. And they're like, what? I go, I've seen coaches completely change things in 2 years. And it's not just winning. It's the whole way they do things. And I also see the happiness in their programs and in the coaches themselves. And so, you know, I saw Al do it. And I think a lot of people at College of Idaho was like, hey, softball did it. I'm gonna jump into that. And now, I mean, you know, and Regan, as I say, is the biggest proponent, and watching the success of College of Idaho as a whole group is pretty mind blowing, right?
Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing you say on some level is, and I agree with this, holistic coaching and mm-hmm. caring about the whole person. I mean, mm-hmm. it's integrated with winning.
Absolutely.
Would you agree with that? Why do you think that is?
Well, you know, one of the big things that we've been focusing on this year, and honestly, people get tired of me talking about University of Oklahoma softball, but I mean, they are the gold standard, right? 3 times national champions. And so much of their winning is focused on that their identity is not in softball, right? Their identity is in something else. Softball is what they do. It's not who they are, right? And what I see in so many student athletes is their value is based on playing time and athletic performance. And so I ask the question a lot of kids and say, if I take your sport away from you, where does your value come from? Most of them cannot answer that. So I come here and tell coaches, your biggest thing that you can do is help your kids understand that their value is not in their performance or their playing time. And this is the time of development that kids are going to figure out what their value systems are, right? Because when they're little, like, you know, 10 and under, their values are pretty much their parents, good or bad, right? And then they move on and they start thinking their friends know everything. So I coach a 13U baseball team, and all the parents are like, why does my 13-year-old think I'm stupid? I go, because you are stupid. And then you look at me, I go, because they're supposed to be stupid. They think their friends are brilliant. They'll grow out of it, right? And then they get to college and they start going, huh, now I get to choose my values, right? And so I've been really communicating with our athletes and our coaches. This is a time, a major value development and self-identity, right? And most of us are like, well, no, duh. That's what happens in college. But I even, you know, put that in front of our kids and say, guys, your value, all your decisions for you. And if you don't have, it's going to be hard to make choices, and especially good choices, right? So if we are looking at these kids' identity and values as why they make all the choices and decisions and why they behave the way they do, that's probably their performance, isn't it? Of course, right? Mm-hmm. And so how to treat the deeper person for them to perform. And I had a coach that goes, okay, my kid's performance anxiety is so high, especially in bigger races. And he goes, I don't understand why. And I said, and I asked, you know, a few background questions. And I go, she will literally like need the biggest hug from me. And then we can get her under control and she can race. And I said, okay. And I go, is her dad in her life? And he goes, I don't think so. And I said, okay. I said, I think, why are you asking that? And I said, well, as we grow up, we are going to search for love in place, you know, from somebody. If we don't get it from mom and dad, we're going to find it from somebody. And I teach coaches, guys, people are going to look to you, your student athletes are going to look to you for love and attention, and it's not going to make sense to you. But it's probably because it didn't come from home. Mm-hmm. But I go, she is needing attention and love from you, and she thinks she only gets it when she performs. And he looks at me and goes, oh my gosh. And he goes, but I told her, like, I'm going to care about her, you know, even if it's unconditional, you know, no matter what. I go, yeah, you're trying to re-hardwire 18 years, right? And he goes, well, it's been 2 years. How long? And I go, but it's going to take a while. I said, but you're going to pour into this kid for 4 years. And then she's going to leave and go, hey, that person stood by me and they showed up every single day. I should be looking for more of that, right? And that's why I always say, coaches, the impact that we have on our student athletes is so massive. And we can look at that as a burden or an opportunity, right? Mm-hmm. And as I say, it's one of the reasons I love the NAIA so much, because I've never met a coach around here that doesn't look at that as an opportunity, yeah. Right? How do I impact lives? That's why we work so much and get paid so little, because we love pouring into our kids to give them a better shot. And so if we don't look at the holistic kid, just doing sports psychology, not that it's not a value, it is, but it's surface. And where we're at in culture and working with our student athletes, we can't just be surface anymore. Mm-hmm. We gotta go deeper.
So one thing I see is, how can coaches get kids, especially early on, to get through the first hard without bailing? Like, we have a coach just this week going through, it's a playing time situation, but the kid that got beat out quit. Yeah. And it's just like, man, if you just would have hung with it, you would have had an opportunity. And, you know, goes to, you don't care about me, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And it's been 6 weeks. So what advice do you have, where I know relationships can't be built very quickly in trust, yeah. But cool. How can we narrow that gap as leaders to build trust?
I'm a big believer in being transparent. I blame my old associate athletic director, Pat Sweeney, who was a lawyer, and he said, get everything in writing. I'm like, oh, fine. By the time I was done coaching, my handbook was way too long. He goes, a little excessive. I go, you said put it all in writing, my friend. And so I always was very transparent about my expectations, how things were going to go, that I value my kids, you know, why I would value a student athlete. Playing time is not, you know, all these things. Mm-hmm. Kids will assume that if they're not playing, that we don't care about them, or it's forever, or that we're after them. And I always tell them, I go, guys, I never wrote a lineup thinking, how do I destroy this kid's life today? That never happened.
And what's funny, I coached for 10 years. Some of my fondest relationships are kids that didn't play all that much.
Well, and that's what I say.
I don't understand that.
Right. I had a kid that was the mama hen, and she took care of one of my freshmen that became the freshman of the year. And once she graduated, I could never replace the role she played, ever. And I'm always like, I don't think she ever truly understood how important of a role she played in the success of our program, right? And so I always wanted kids to understand that. I had a kid that showed up and just wanted to throw batting practice. I was like, I don't understand what you just said. She goes, I don't need money. I don't need playing time. I go, what? And she threw off speed and we sucked at off speed. So I said, hey, that'd be great. And I would tell her all the time, I'm like, you're going to be the reason we go deep this year. And that was the deepest we ever went. We finished third in the country. And I know that that kid is one of the main reasons why. And so you have to tell kids what their role is and also what they're going to gain from sticking it out. That's the thing. Athletes get a million things from being a student athlete that has nothing to do with playing time. You know, and I say, guys, do you know that athletes get hired at a higher rate? Why? Because of all these skills you have. I will tell my team that, right? And I will tell my team as new kids, I'll be like, guys, the first year is hard. It is really hard because you're transitioning and you might have been all state, but now everybody's all state. And these are the things that you need to realize as you go through this transition, right? Be transparent. Explain what's going to happen. I'm also an internal check. I am an excessive checker inner, right? I check on my kids probably too much. And I always, and I say, you know, I say to kids or school, or excuse me, I say to coaches with big rosters, I go, guys, I know, you know, lacrosse teams might have 60 guys. Get it. I said, do you realize though, if you took 10 minutes every day, and even if it took you 2 months and then you started over and you just sent a text message to your student athlete saying, hey, I'm just checking in on you. I want to see how things are going at school. Do you know what that would mean to that kid? It'd be a game changer. And yeah, it only takes you 10 minutes, right? And so those things of showing them value and worth and investment that still hold them to you when playing time can't always be the thing that fuels them, mm-hmm, right? It's communicating and building that relationship with the kid.
Gosh, and the kid that sticks with it and deals with the disappointment of not playing, mm-hmm, I think they, mm-hmm, see the most growth out of their athletic experience.
Absolutely. And one of the biggest problems, you know, when people say, you know, I'll be like, what's the biggest problem in the world? Everybody tells me a million things, you know, social media, the government, all this stuff. I go, no, it's that we can't be uncomfortable. And since these kids are uncomfortable because they're not playing, they're going to quit and run away. And that doesn't build strength. That doesn't build confidence. Right. So these kids, mm-hmm, that are trying to run away from stress or discomfort, they're always going to run away. And that's kind of where we are in this generation. If it's uncomfortable, we do something about it. We take a pill, we buy something, we drink substances, we avoid it. And the thing is teaching kids like, hey, enduring hard is going to make you a stronger, more confident person on the flip side. Yeah. But you have to commit to that. Right. Mm-hmm.
So shifting gears a little bit, a note I made, yeah, as you were telling us about yourself was how your goal is accessibility at all times.
Yeah. Yeah.
That makes sense to me. But, mm-hmm, then I felt like a light bulb went off. I never heard the term emotional entitlement.
Me either. It's brilliant though.
Yeah, it's just like, it all makes sense.
Yeah.
Talk more. I don't even know how to phrase my question other than talk more about that. Mm-hmm. And I do think I think the second question to this is coaches are expected to be academic counselor, mental health counselor, this, that, all this different stuff. What's your advice just to coaches to dealing with this emotional entitlement piece? But first explain it again, because if it's a new term to me, I think I'm at least not alone in that.
Yeah, no. Yeah. When my professor said that, I go, maybe you should write a book. And he's like, yeah, I hate writing. I go, you tell me to write all the time. It's funny traveling across the country and seeing different athletes from different regions. And I've spent my whole life on the Western side of the United States, but most of it in the Pacific Northwest. And there's definitely a different mentality in the Pacific Northwest, I think, than any other place. And to be honest, I would say that we're definitely a place of emotional entitlement, which means that everybody needs to work around our feelings, right? And I'm, you know, and I communicate with student athletes. I go, if there's 60 kids on a team, how is coach going to manage each one of your emotions that day? And they always look at me. I go, guys, it's impossible. I said, my team used to think that I thought about all of them individually all the time. And I finally said one day, I go, guys, I don't think about you individually that much. I said, if I give you all an hour every day, I would never sleep. I go, my job as the head coach is to think of you as a collective unit and get you going in the right direction. I go, the people that I probably think about the most are my injured kids. One, because I was an injured kid and I am very empathetic and sympathetic. I go, and I want to make sure that they're on track to do the things that they do need to do so they can get back, right? I said, that doesn't mean I don't love you. I said, but I'm a big, you know, we have to be big picture. And I literally said to a group today, I go, you guys that are 20, you're selfish. And I look, and they kind of look at me. I go, I know I'm not supposed to tell you you're selfish. I go, but you are. I said, and you're supposed to be. I said, your developmental stage is, I got to figure out how to do me. I said, it's like when eighth graders want to date somebody. I go, you barely know how to stay alive, let alone try and keep somebody else alive, right? I said, this is the time that you're trying to figure out how to be an adult. I said, but we've taken it to an extreme. You know, and it's funny, like when people say, well, just do you, I'm like, or everything you do impacts your teammates, you know? And so they think that as long as they feel okay, it doesn't matter about the people around them. Well, we all know that that's not true, right? And one of the things that I saw on the back of a t-shirt was, your choices impact everybody on your team. And I was like, yep, that is true, right? So if you want to feel bad about somebody like cutting you off in traffic all day and you bring it to practice, how does that impact the person next to you? If you don't take care of something and you're so stressed and anxious about it and you come to practice and underperform, whose responsibility is that? It's not coaches, right? And so one of the things that we talk about in my practice a lot, and I know the word victim is probably a bad word to use, but we talk about the difference between being a champion and a victim, right? And I work with a lot of people with chronic medical stuff, young people. And some of them, oh my gosh, they've been through the worst stuff and they are just the most amazing people. And those people, yeah, they've been victims of bad circumstances and medical stuff, but they're champions because they choose to not let that destroy who they are or their you know, what is possible in their life, right? And on the West Coast, honestly, being a victim is kind of trendy. And I'm always like, why do you want to victimize yourself? All of us go back through bad things. Everybody does, right? But you get to choose to rise up over that, or you get to choose to have it determine who you are and what your value and identity is. So that's always a choice. And I'm really big on the choices. Kids always have choices. They think the coach owns them. The coach doesn't own them. They could walk out the door. Now, are there consequences? Absolutely.
I don't know if it's inappropriate or not. One of my lines I said to a team once is, this is not a jail. You can choose to leave at any time.
Right. Absolutely. You know, and I always refer to Dangerous Minds, you know, the famous 90s movie when they talk about, well, if you have a gun to your head, you don't have a choice. And then somebody goes, well, yes, you do. Because you can either go down hard or you can go down easy. So if you always have a choice, you can choose to be a victim. She literally says in that classroom, the teacher, Michelle Pfeiffer, goes, there are no victims in this classroom. And, you know, who knows? 90 movies, man, they just preach it like nobody else can. But that's the thing is I communicate with my kids, you know, and I coach a little, you know, younger, I coach high school now. But it's like, guys, you choose if this day is going to be a nightmare or not. Because days are going to be difficult. You choose if you're going to be victimized by it or you're going to be a champion. That's up to you.
Do you think, because the developmental stages piece, I think those have held true over time. Like, I don't think when me and you were that age, we were any more or less selfish probably. But it's, and I do have a problem with blaming social media probably more than I should.
Me too. No, I do too. I can't handle it.
But
I blames it.
But I go when we're talking the emotional entitlement and you do you, that kind of thing. I go to social media because you can go there for affirmation. And you can go after others. Do you think that's a fair take?
Yeah, I think that's a fair take. Different. Yeah. Or it may be a thought that they never thought about. But they also get to choose if they pursue it or not. But yeah, I think it's affirmation. I totally do. And I also think you hear things enough, you know, you go, oh, maybe that is true because everybody's saying it. And, you know, that's like when the whole fake news concept came out and stuff. If you hear things, even if it's a lie enough, you start to believe it, right? I mean, that's how cults get started, for Pete's sake, you know? And so that's the thing is they might see it and then they might go, yeah, I like that. Or they might go, well, that makes my life easier. So I'm going to follow that.
Yeah, or I can go announce, so I'm leaving, I'm going to transfer, and people will celebrate me, say, you're on to big things, and it just builds a lie.
Well, and that's the other thing, like, you know, probably more in my generation, you know, all the elite kids would play on one team, and so you'd have, like, these six teams that were freaking just dynamos. Well, now it becomes, well, I didn't get my way, so I'm going to go start a new team. And so there's 7,000 teams, and kids aren't learning how to win, they're learning how to get recruited. And so they don't know how to be selfless. They don't know how to focus on the outcome as a unit. And so when they get to college, coaches are having to teach kids how to win.
Absolutely.
Right? Because getting recruited is the priority now, and that shouldn't be what it is.
But at the same token, I mean, me and you benefited from that at coaching because I was an old baseball coach, and it sure was great going to sit at a showcase all day. Everybody got their forward bats in an inning, then switch sides and keep going, and I could see everybody a lot quicker.
Okay, but do you know
they,
what?
They dictated that for us, but
yeah, I never went to showcases for that very reason.
Well, you're a purist. I took advantage of it.
Well, it's funny because somebody would come to me and say, "Hey, who are you looking at?" And I'd be like, "Well, I'm looking at so-and-so." And they'd say, "Well, do you want me to put them in the game?" And I'm like, "No." I go, "If they can't start for you, they're not going to start for me. So that just means that they're probably not a fit for me." Right?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I think I'm a little bit more cutthroat when it comes to all
But I think it's real easy to blame others. I look at just the system in general. Mm-hmm. It's easier for us working in it to blame parents, kids, whatever. Yep. But we're part of the system.
There's
some power of us how it's evolved. We've allowed it on some level.
And to be honest, I think that's why I wanted to shift what I do for a living, because I didn't want to be part of a system anymore. I wanted to help people work around, you know, not necessarily work around it, but have skills to not have to cave into it. Yeah, right?
I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
Okay. I got two more questions and we'll go to the rapid fire round. So one is, I mean, you work with such a broad range from high school to college, NAIA, you have a D1 background. Yeah. I'm interested from a coaching leadership perspective, the similarities and differences you see from different genders, different levels of how to work with them holistically and help them perform.
You know, as I say, we want to start developing things as young as 5, because we want this just to be how things are, not that we have to fix things on the end. We want to be definitely more proactive in the future. Right. And I work, you know, and then you work up to, you know, pro athletes. Some things that are all the same. Motivation is one. Like, you know, getting kids to understand what motivates them to go compete and practice and train, right? I have that question with little kids. I have that question with pro athletes. You know, sometimes pro athletes, they forget why they started, right? Or their why has changed. Like, I'm doing this for this reason. And lots of times they get so wrapped up in the money or the numbers, they forget of why they even are really doing this. Because I say, you know, sports are stupid when you think about it. I mean, my sport, you hit a ball and run around to 4 pillows. Like, why? That's dumb. Like, what, you know, how does that make millions of dollars? Right. But there's deeper reasons why we get started and also why we stick in it. And I want our kids to always understand that. Right. The other thing too, is they just want to be connected to their coach. Right. You can't tell me that Michael Jordan didn't want to be connected to Phil Jackson. You can't tell me that that relationship meant nothing to him. There's no way. Right. And that's the thing, is they just want to be heard. They want to be seen. They want to be appreciated, and they want to be part of something bigger than themselves. And that's even true for like individual athletes. Like, the golfer still wants to be part of something bigger, whether it's a golf team or even a pro being part of the tour. They want to be part of something bigger. Right. And they, you know, they all do want to enjoy it. I literally sit with kids, and when we do, time management stuff. And I said, you know, guys, I know that you think that your recreation time is not your sport. I go, but it is. And I go, my kids that are teenagers are like, well, I was so busy, I was at theater all day. I go, yeah, theater's your hobby. And you and I as professionals, like, can you imagine getting to do your hobby 2 hours every day? That would be awesome. But the mindset gets changed to we have to instead of we get to. Right. And I think that at all levels, at some, you know, sometimes we look at it as drudgery, but really, I would tell my college athletes, I go, you guys get paid to go to grown-up recess. It's the best thing in the world.
Mm-hmm. Right? Do you see any difference of all the different levels or even different genders, like, of how to approach coaching and leading to this generation of athlete?
As I say, listen to them. It's okay for them to ask you why you're doing something. Okay. They're not questioning if you're good at your job. They want to know why they're investing in it, right? That's true of either gender, any age. You know, when I was playing, if you ask the coach why we're doing this, coach, oh, snap, you're running. Like, it wasn't allowed. And now it's, they want to understand so they can buy in. So I'm happy to explain. I also look at it as, I'm happy to explain because I want kids to be coaches down the road. So that's how they're going to learn. I'll be happy to tell them, right? And, you know, and I think that's fair to say wherever, right? And kids do want to be challenged and they want structure. Those are things that are important. We think kids say they don't want structure. They thrive off of it.
Absolutely. Right?
So that's always going to be an important thing to do. Hold the kids accountable and give structure, which are two things in regular society we don't do a very good job about.
Yeah, right on. Yeah. So my last one's a little, I'm going to preface it because it's a little politically incorrect potentially. So
bring it on.
You captured me when you spoke, because I don't know how many times I've had a coach come to me and say, what do I do? A kid just told me they're just overwhelmed. They need to take a day off. Uh-huh. They have a mental health day, this kind of thing. And that is dangerous territory for us non-professionals. And you made a statement when I heard you talk the first time of, you know what, sometimes that's true. Sometimes it's crap. Yeah. and I just appreciated the, yes, somebody saying it out loud. And I preface that saying depression runs in my family. I've been diagnosed with anxiety, I've medicated for it. So I know it's real, but I mean, just navigating that for coaches is so hard, and it goes above their education level, pay grade, whatever. So a school that doesn't have costs working with them has a, like our, we have free counseling for 6 sessions for every student, but it can be hard to get in there.
Yep.
What are practical ways for coaches to approach that situation to care about kids, but also make sure they're not getting taken advantage of?
Yeah. And so there's some basic questions that I ask, and I mean, I'm a professional and I still ask them, right? And I teach our coaches to ask them, and I have the athletes ask themselves, right? So anxiety is such a massive thing. That's probably the number one thing I deal with. And if I ask a kid what's causing their anxiety, they usually couldn't answer me, right? But if I say to them, what's your biggest worry? They can answer that. Or if I say, what is the last hamster on the wheel as you go to sleep? They can probably tell me what it is, right? So if an athlete comes and says, I need a mental health day, right? I'd say, hey, what are you struggling with? Well, my anxiety is really high. Okay. So what's been your biggest worry? If they can tell you, then it might be like, okay, well, you know what? I just found out that your dad decided to, told your mom that we're getting divorced, and now you don't know if you're going to be able to pay for school and all these things. Okay, I get it, right? That's probably an acute thing, that is an overload day. I get it, right? Or if it's maybe like, well, this has been going on and is a chronic thing, it may be, okay, yep, we'll give you this day. You also need to go make an appointment, right? And it may be a little bit till they get in, but they still need to make an appointment, because I always want kids to have action plans. They just want the day off and not have any consequences or any action. Right? It's kind of the same as venting. They just want to vent, but never fix anything. And we need to give them a plan of attack. And that doesn't necessarily mean that the coach has to fix it. It's what is the action plan, right? Maybe a kid is like, yeah, I've been really struggling and I've hardly eaten. It's, hey, we need to figure out, this is what's going on. We need to get a plan of, do we need you to see a nutritionist? Or is it, I just can't eat because I broke up with my boyfriend, right? And so it may also be, hey, you may not be able to practice tomorrow. Are you able to do this today? Or let's check in tomorrow and, kind of a plan of attack. Some of it's just what they're going to say, but if they just say they want a mental health day, they could take advantage of that all day long, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the kids when I was growing up that said they were sick, but really they were hungover and they didn't complain. Right? Yeah. And to be honest, I'm a non-drinker, so I'd get really ticked off because I'm like, dude, I'm here at 6 a.m. every day running. And I hate mornings and I hate running, but I love softball. So I did not understand why that was like kind of just like let that slide. So it's also like they need to ask the next question, or like, hey, I'm really having trouble sleeping. And it may be the question of, what's your biggest worry? Is there something going on in your life that's really, weighing on you? Because it could be a depressive situation, right? One of the things.
Right on. Well.
Well, one of the things, and this last thing I'll give you, but one of the things that was really beneficial, and I actually learned this from our youth pastor, is we would do check-ins when I started coaching high school. And I know every coach does not want to give up any free time of their practice. I get it, but we would do it 3 days a week for 10 minutes. And our assistant, or me and my assistants would just stand in a line, like across from each other. And the kids would come in and we'd ask them questions like, hey, is there any struggle at home? How are school, like kind of just checking off the major parts of our kids' lives. And a lot of people are like, but why would I give up time? And I'm like, because the kids can kind of unload. You also can find out what's going on in their lives. And then the last question would be, Do you feel mentally prepared to go into practice? Well, most of the time the answer is yes, right? But it also gives them that ability to dump more focused on practice. So their quality of practice got better, right? So I would say, do you want to give up 30 minutes in a week to have good practice? Do you just want things to stay the status quo, right? So those simple things of connecting and finding out and being preventative are going to keep you from the crisis that you're calling the cops or running them to, you know, inpatient or last minute need to get into a counselor. So it's those preventative measures that can be really helpful.
Well said. Well, as an affirmation to your work I've had since I heard you speak, I have this electronic to-do list and some things repeat every day. And I have repeated every day, ask coaches their biggest worry.
Yeah.
I thought that was when they're venting, when they just, whatever, that question has been very helpful to me because it gets below the surface and allows you to help if there's help needed.
Well, and as people that are in the world of sports, we're fixers and we want to do it quickly because we know that every day lost is a day that we aren't being successful or growing or winning, right? And so we want to jump in and get moving. That's why I say most of my athletes don't see me probably more than 3 times because we get in, we figure out what's going on and we give the skill and we get them back out there, right?
Yep, right on. All right, we'll wrap up with, call it a rapid fire round, but you don't have any longer than 30 seconds to answer any of these questions.
Okay.
All right. So, what is one book that has greatly influenced your life?
The Shack.
Good choice. How has a failure or apparent failure set you up for later success?
I did not give the right punishment to one of my student athletes, and it totally drove a wedge in between me and my assistant. And now I always worry about hurting people's feelings. And now I just like, no, punishment is punishment. It doesn't matter who you are.
Right. What is your favorite podcast?
To be honest, I feel like I talk and listen all day long. So I listen to show tunes. I don't do podcasts, I'll admit. Nice. I don't even like listening to my own. So no, my daughter's a theater kid. So bring on the show tunes, my friend.
What's your favorite musical? I'm a musical guy myself.
I really do want to say, I do love Hamilton, but the grandiosity of Wicked is just unbelievable to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Oh, on. But you know what? Michael Jackson, I have to say MJ the musical, game changer. Yeah.
Never seen that one.
Yeah. It just came out last year. Yeah. It's pretty impressive.
Well, my claim to fame to make this about myself is I was Harold Hill in The Music Man in 8th grade.
Yes! I thought The Music Man. Yeah. I saw it actually with Hugh Jackman.
Yeah, well, I can still do that opening scene, but I never got a lead again after that. So take that as you will. How do you define success in your work?
For me, it's like the impact I can make in kids to help them choose to make change.
Right on. Last one. In the last 5 years, what new belief, behavior, or habit has most improved your life?
I literally trained my brain not to worry anymore. My mom had a stroke and my mom is like one of the most important people in my life. And I didn't know what was going to come out of that. And I literally was like, okay, it's okay to worry. And I like literally can't. And cause I told myself worry does not serve. Worry does not keep people safe. Worry does not make people feel love. All it did was wreak havoc on my nervous system and make my chronic pain worse. And now that I don't let worry come into my daily, I live in such a freer life. It's unbelievable.
Wow. Well, there's your book right there. You can write that and if you don't have to worry. You'll be.
I know. All my moms are like, wait, you don't have anxiety or worry? I go, no. They're like, how did you do that? And I'm like, yeah, it's a little bit more complicated, you know, than just a text message.
Yeah. Well, this was awesome. So much good stuff. Thank you. Thank you for joining me.
You bet. So, I'm happy to always chat. As I say, it's funny. I talk about mental health all day, but I love the population I work with so much. I love student athletes. I love working with coaches. And as I say, that's probably the biggest joy is that I get to be with them. And it's funny because I'll get on a plane tonight and probably be in tears going, oh my gosh, I have to leave them behind, even though it's been 3 days. But, you know, I get to like be at home at so many campuses. It's really awesome.
Cool. So if anybody wanted to get hold of you, what's the best way for them to do that?
Honestly, you can text me. I function like an athletic director. Like I said, I don't sleep very much. So yeah, people can text me or they can get me at coachcause@trainingthecompleteathlete.com. I mean, seriously, Robert, you can freaking put my cell phone in the notes.
Okay. Well, I'll make sure that gets in there when you publish this.
You bet. Awesome. Thank you, my friend.
Cool. Have a great day. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Beyond Coaching. We hope today's discussion provided you with insights into understanding and leading. As always, thank you to the 3D Institute and Friends University for their support and passion for empowering leaders. And if you have any questions for today's guest or myself, all our contact information is in the show notes. Thanks for tuning in.